subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
It's been a year since the status of Jammu and Kashmir, as we had known it for the past 7 decades, changed completely. At around 11 a.m. on 5th August, Amit Shah announced in the Rajya Sabha that the government had decided to do away with the state's special status.
We घोषणा करते हैं कि यह दिनांक जिस दिन भारत के राष्ट्रपति द्वारा इस घोषणा पर हस्ताक्षर किए जाएंगे और इस सरकारी इसे सरकारी गैजेट में प्रकाशित किया जाएगा, उस दिन से अनुच्छेद 370 के सभी खंड लागू नहीं होंगे।
Two presidential orders were then issued, effectively scrapping Article 370 and Article 35A of the Constitution. Now, Article 370 exempted Jammu and Kashmir from the provisions of the Indian Constitution, allowing it to frame its own constitution. It also spoke about the applicability of central laws to the state. This meant that Parliament needed the state government's concurrence for applying laws to the state, except for laws which dealt with defence, foreign affairs, finance and communications. It also gave power to the President to apply different provisions of the Constitution to the state. But it required the President to secure the concurrence of the Jammu and Kashmir government before issuing such an order. As for Article 35A, it was introduced through a presidential order in 1954, allowing the Jammu and Kashmir legislature to decide who all are the permanent members of the state. This was the article that formed the basis of the special rights and privileges that could be granted to the residents of the state in public sector jobs, acquisition of property in the state, scholarships and other public aid and welfare. On 9th August, the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act was also passed. The law bifurcated the state into two union territories, the Union Territory of Ladakh and the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, while the move came as a surprise and even a shock for some, the revocation of Article 370 had been a long-standing promise of the BJP. In the past year, despite several curbs in the form of detentions and internet shutdowns, the political situation in the valley continues to pose several challenges for the Modi government. Here's our associate editor Neelam Pandey with more details.
When Prime Minister Narendra Modi delivered his first speech after doing away with Article 370 in Jammu and Kashmir last year, he had said the move will allow people to choose their own representative and chief minister. Doing away with Article 370 from Jammu and Kashmir has been in the BJP's must-do list for a long time, and successive BJP election manifestos have talked about doing away with this contentious Article 370. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, the founder of Jan Sangh, was strongly opposed to Article 370 and he saw it as a threat to national unity. In fact, he raised the slogan in the context of Jammu and Kashmir, Ek Desh Mein Do Vidhan, Do Pradhan Aur Do Nishan Nahin Chalenge. In his speech, Prime Minister Narendra Modi last year had said people of Jammu and Kashmir did not get an opportunity to become leaders in their own state because of dynasty-ruled parties. He was referring to National Conference leaders Farooq Abdullah and Omar Abdullah and PDP chief Mehbooba Mufti. After doing away with Article 370, the Bharatiya Janata Party had also hoped that this would give rise to a new crop of leaders and leadership. The Modi government had in fact adopted several hard measures, including snapping the phone and internet lines, putting scores of mainstream political leaders under house arrest. But despite all this, the new leadership is still not visible on the ground. The BJP, on the other hand, has lost its own party functionaries. The Jammu and Kashmir unit of the Bharatiya Janata Party had earlier demanded security cover for its own political workers who were facing threats. They had pointed out that they are busy upholding democracy in the Union Territory and they have to face these attacks. One of the party leaders of the Bharatiya Janata Party, Waseem Bari, was killed by militants in Bandipora district along with his brother and father in July. Bari was one of the many grassroots leaders of the Bharatiya Janata Party who had been trying to penetrate Kashmir society through Panchayati Raj and various social welfare schemes. Another political headache for the Bharatiya Janata Party government is to provide security and accommodation not only to the winning candidates of urban local body and panchayat elections, but even those who contested the elections unsuccessfully. This is because the then governor Satyapal Malik had promised them security cover if they decided to contest. Instead, most of these candidates have been housed in over 24 hotels in Srinagar and are not even able to venture out of their homes and constituencies due to the militant threat. As it is, no political activities have started in the region, and sooner or later, the Modi government will have to take measures to bring back normalcy in the valley. While Mehbooba Mufti continues to be under house arrest, NC leader Omar Abdullah in interviews has pointed out that he will not contest assembly elections till Jammu and Kashmir remains a union territory. It is definitely about time the NDA government at the centre starts the process of restoring normalcy and political activities in the region.
Clearly, a lot needs to be done to restore normalcy in the Union Territory. Meanwhile, the continued incarceration of several political leaders in Jammu and Kashmir has only added to the ambiguity around the future of Jammu and Kashmir politics. Our special correspondent Azan Javed brings us the ground reality from Srinagar.
Politics in Jammu and Kashmir continues to be engulfed in a cloud of uncertainty and quite proven by the developments on Friday, wherein the Jammu and Kashmir administration extended the Public Safety Act against former Jammu and Kashmir Chief Minister and President of the People's Democratic Party, Mehbooba Mufti. Mehbooba Mufti has been in detention for almost a year now, and she is not the only one. Among the over 6,500 people who were arrested and detained last year ahead of Modi government's decision, politicians of all the regional parties, even the National Party Congress, were taken into preventive custody. Some of them, especially the first rung of PDP and NC, were later booked under the Public Safety Act. Now, this is not the entire picture. Essentially, government has been claiming that they have been, since last October, releasing politicians in a phase-wise manner. But that is not the case that the politicians here plead. They are saying that though they have been released, they have been directed either informally or through verbal orders that they will not leave their residences, essentially putting them under something called the house arrest. In Kashmir, would mostly associate with the incarceration of separatist leaders, especially Saeed Ali Shagilani. However, mainstream politicians detained at designated sub-jails or at their houses has kind of been a shock to the mainstream political ecosystem who have advocated Indian democracy in Jammu and Kashmir. The recent case of Professor Saifuddin Soz, a senior Congress leader and a union minister also, is kind of an example of what the mainstream here is going through. J&K administration, however, said that Professor Soz was free and he can go and visit anyone. However, video interviews of Mr. Soz that were taken following the petition proved otherwise. Even Sajjad Loan, People's Conference Chairman, announced that he is being released. He also used the word that he is a free man. However, when we talked to his party men, they told us that he was later informed that he cannot move out of his home till the August 5. These are some of the issues that the political mainstream has been facing since last year, but the amplification of their troubles came in March when the COVID-19 pandemic hit Jammu and Kashmir. In March, it was an important month for at least the political ecosystem here because Dr. Farooq Abdullah was released, his PSA was revoked, and a few days later, son Umar Abdullah was also released, and people here were expecting some kind of rejuvenation in the mainstream politics that was going to come. However, Farooq Abdullah, when he was released, he said that he will talk politics only after other detained politicians were released. Umar Abdullah said that talking politics will not be appropriate, and once the COVID challenge is done with, then the national conference politics will restart. That has not exactly been the case. They have been issuing statements criticizing the domicile law and other moves that the Modi government and the J&K administration has been making here. But the mainstream politicians here, they are in a state of limbo, essentially. The communications blackout and the clampdown that took place last year had majorly hit their political activity. Umar Abdullah, in a recent interview, told the print that the future roadmap of the national conference will only be decided when the working committee of the party will be able to meet. He said that 16 of his top leaders are still in house detention, and it won't be possible for him or his father to take a decision without the working committee. PDP's Naeem Akhtar, a senior leader in the party, also spoke to the print earlier this week, and he also said that the party is clear that they do not accept the decision taken on August 5th last year, but the future roadmap will only be decided after Mehbooba Mufti is released. Murabla in the same interview said that Modi government's decision actually has given playing field to separatist groups here, separatist constituencies here, who he said their stand was vindicated because they were the ones who were telling people of Jammu and Kashmir not to trust New Delhi. Now, what will be the future roadmap? It remains to be unseen. But one of the key pieces in that puzzle is the Gupta Declaration. If you remember that the Gupta Declaration was something which was signed by all political parties, regional parties, 370. They sensed that the Modi government might be making a move against the special status of Jammu and Kashmir. So they signed the declaration and kind of opened a united front against the centre at that time, and even said that tinkering of the special status will be an act of war against the people of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, to look back at their words and to chart out their future is a very precarious situation that the political parties here are dealing with. They are being accused of instigating violence, provoking people, and on the second hand, they have to reach out to the people at some point and tell them what their stand is. Now, what their stand will be is something which remains to be seen, whether they will commit to the promises and the words they've spoken or some of them fall is something Jammu and Kashmir is yet to witness.
Now, while we wait to see how the politics in Jammu and Kashmir takes shape, let us take a look at whether the revocation of Article 370 had any effect on terrorism in the region. The Prince senior associate editor Snehesh Alex Philip has all the details.
On the security front, terrorism continues to be the main challenge in Jammu and Kashmir even today, as was the case before the revocation of Article 370 and the division of the state into two union territories. Ahead of the August 5 move last year, the centre had pumped in additional number of troops into the then state of Jammu and Kashmir. According to even conservative estimates, over 60,000 additional troops were pumped in. Such was the focus on security that National Security Advisor Ajit Doval camped in the valley for nearly a fortnight and personally handled the security arrangements. Except for sporadic protests limited to specific areas, the situation remained much calmer than even expected. This was primarily because of the heavy presence of security personnel in the state. Since the focus was on law and order rather than counter-terrorism and counter-insurgency, the operations by the security forces came down immediately after the revocation of Article 370. The government did not want to risk the peace by carrying out an operation. Between August and December 2019, 25 terrorists were killed, bringing the total number of terrorists killed in 2019 to 152. This meant that majority of the kills took place before the revocation of Article 370 on August 5, 2019. And this year, till 3rd of May, the figure for terrorists killed was 64. However, this saw a substantial jump because as per official figures, a total of 148 terrorists have been killed as of 30th July. In terms of local recruitment, a total of 219 locals had joined the terror groups in 2018, which dropped to 119 in 2019. This year, the figure stood at 74 as of 30th June, despite the corona pandemic and the lockdown. However, what is of achievement to the security forces is that top leaders of HM, Jaish-e-Mohammed and LET have been killed in operation. Also, another factor is that this year only 70 minor terror-related incidents have taken place as compared to 107 for the same period last year. In addition, 6 attempts of IED blast were foiled in the current year as a result of proactiveness of the intelligence agencies and alert troops on the ground.
Certainly, terrorism continues to be a challenge, although the data is beginning to show a decline in violence. Ananya Bharadwaj, our senior assistant editor, traveled to Kashmir immediately after the revocation of Article 370, bringing you perspectives and stories from the ground.
It was a tough and very challenging time.
There was heavy deployment of forces across the state. The locals were extremely angry, and pockets of downtown Kashmir were volatile, with incidents of stone pelting and violent clashes with the forces being reported on a daily basis. The biggest challenge as a reporter was to move around amidst heavy security to reach the troubled pockets without phones, as telephone connectivity was suspended, and then to convince the locals to speak to us. What we observed was that there was a great deal of mistrust among locals for various media channels and media houses. They addressed us as the Indian government mouthpieces. Locals there believed that most media outlets do not want to show the truth, as it goes against the narrative of the government. Such was the anger that at places, locals even snatched the camera of my photographer Praveen Jain, and in fact, he was also heckled by the crowd. It took us a lot of effort to assure them that we were there to report the ground realities and that they should open up to us. At times, we also got caught up in the crossfire between the locals pelting stones and the forces. With no vehicles and us walking at least 20 to 30 kilometers a day, there were instances where we had to even run for our lives and take shelter in a local's house to dodge the pellets and the stones. In Kashmir, it does not matter if you are from the media. A pellet or a stone can come from anywhere and at any time. A place can appear to be extremely peaceful and beautiful at one time, but can turn turbulent within minutes. Just a week after the revocation of Article 370 was announced, we went to Sora, a place in downtown Kashmir where a severe clash between the locals and the forces had occurred. While the entire Jammu and Kashmir administrative ecosystem, from the state police to government hospital authorities, maintained that there were no pellet victims and that protests following the Modi government's decision to scrap 370 have largely been peaceful, we traced down 5 victims who in fact sustained pellet wounds. The story of 14-year-old Asrar Wani is worth a mention here. I somehow got inside the Sher-e-Kashmir Institute of Medical Sciences Hospital and pulled out records of Wani, who had sustained serious injuries in one such clash between the locals and the forces. When we went there, we saw that he had abrasions on his left eye and had fractured both his legs, his collarbone and arms. He was in fact on a life support and was admitted in an ICU. The doctors at the hospital were extremely reluctant to share the details of the injuries and were very tight-lipped. A few days later, he passed away. The J&K police maintained that no bullets or pellets were used on locals, and Wani in fact had died of a blunt injury, maybe after his head hit with a stone. But a post-mortem report accessed by the print showed that he had died of a shell blast on his head. We found and reported many such cases wherein pellet victims claimed that the hospital authorities even in fact refused to treat them, as they did not want those injuries on hospital records. But many doctors went to their homes after being off duty to treat them. Another scare among the locals in the valley was of being picked up by the police. Outside the district collector's office in Srinagar, we found every day there was a long queue of parents whose children had been picked up by the police under the Public Safety Act and stuffed in jails. Many came every day with a representation but returned empty-handed. Although in the last 1 year there have been many instances of locals picking up arms and joining the militant cadres, something that the government of India assured would not happen, Kashmir has otherwise been calm. Whether the reason for this is the heavy deployment, suspended internet, political detentions, a series of encounters, we are not sure. A clearer picture would emerge only after the restrictions are eased completely, the 4G internet is restored and all detainees are released. As we observed in Kashmir, events can take a turn at any point. We can only hope that they are for the best.
Now, considering the disputed status of Kashmir and the UN resolutions associated with it over the decades, there was quite a bit of international chatter on the Modi government's move. While some countries came forward supporting the Indian government, others also raised severe concerns on Delhi's unilateral decision. More on this from our senior associate editor, Nainima Basu.
The revocation of Article 370 and 35A largely invited support from most of the P5 countries, which are permanent members of the UN Security Council, except China, which said that India was attempting to change the status quo unilaterally by this action.
It's obvious that the constitutional amendment by India has changed the status quo in Kashmir, causing tensions in the region.
In fact, Chinese Foreign Minister State Councillor Wang Yi said in his remarks at the UN General Assembly meeting last year in September that the Kashmir dispute is a dispute left from the past, should be peacefully resolved and properly addressed in accordance to the UN Charter, Security Council resolutions and bilateral agreement. Apart from China, others such as Turkey urged a dialogue on this issue between India and Pakistan and not through collision. This event reportedly led Prime Minister Narendra Modi to cancel his trip to Ankara later that year. Ties with Malaysia also hit a rough patch with the move, even as their former Prime Minister Mahathir Mohamad accused India of invading and occupying Kashmir in his exact words. While Malaysia saw a change of regime after that, the bilateral relationship between Kuala Lumpur and New Delhi continues to remain tense. However, countries such as the US, the UK, France and Russia supported India's move and saw it as India's internal matter, even as they advocated de-escalation of tensions between India and Pakistan. Pakistan, on the other hand, saw this move to be the last nail in the coffin in the bilateral relationship, while the Modi government remained firm on not having a dialogue with Pakistan as long as it continues to harbour terror. The Imran Khan government downgraded diplomatic ties between the two within just 2 days of the move. On August 7th, at a meeting of the National Security Committee summoned by Prime Minister Imran Khan, Islamabad took the decisions to issue orders asking then Indian High Commissioner to Pakistan, Ajay Bisaria, to return to New Delhi, while it also did not allow their newly appointed envoy to India, Moinul Haq, to take over charge in India. The bilateral ties, the diplomatic ties between India and Pakistan continues to remain downgraded. But interestingly, despite these tensions, both sides came together for the opening of the Kartarpur corridor in November, which is now closed from the Indian side due to the pandemic situation. The move also had repercussions in the US Congress as well. The Trump administration walked the diplomatic tightrope, telling the US Congress that there is a humanitarian crisis in Jammu and Kashmir, and adding that the relationship with India is not that of dictation, but of partnership. Meanwhile, the European Union saw the development with grave concern as far as human rights concerns were concerned. The Indian government even organized a trip to Kashmir for the members of European parliamentarians, which was severely criticized as propagating a false narrative, even as Kashmir continued to remain under a lockdown mode with no internet or phone connections at that time. In January this year, the Modi government organized another guided tour of Jammu and Kashmir for 15 envoys, which included the US Ambassador to India, Kenneth Juster, and ambassadors of Germany, Vietnam, Bangladesh, and South Korea, among others.
Back home, the move hit the region's economy hard over the past year, says our senior associate editor Ramya Nair, with several industries coming to a standstill.
For the Jammu and Kashmir economy, the last 1 year has not been an easy one. Its economy was projected to reach Rs 2 lakh crore in 2020-21 from Rs 1.8 lakh crore in 2019-20. But it is expected to fall well short of these numbers for both these years. The double whammy of the fallout of the revocation of Article 370 and subsequent curbs on the internet, as well as the COVID-19 pandemic, has meant that many sectors have seen large-scale disruption. Experts tracking the state say horticulture was one of the worst hit, with farmers not able to sell both their apple and cherry crops outside of the state despite measures announced by the center. The tourism industry came to a virtual standstill, adversely impacting not only hotels and tour operators, but restaurants and cafes dependent on the influx of tourists. This has meant widespread job losses and rising unemployment rates in the state. The artisan economy, those making shawls, carpets and other crafts, are also faced with plunging sales. With the state now being bifurcated into two union territories, the budget for 2020-21 for Jammu and Kashmir as well as Ladakh was presented by Union Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman in March this year in Parliament. The budget estimates that the nominal GDP growth for the state in 2019-20 is 13.3%, an estimate that economists dismiss as wishful thinking. The nominal GDP growth for 2020-21 is estimated at 11.8%, again unlikely to be achieved due to the pandemic. The fine print of the revenue and expenditure numbers show capital expenditure slowed down substantially and revenues plunged during the year. capital expenditure in the first 7 months of 2019-20 was only at 19.5% of the full year estimates, showing a sharp fall in development expenditure. Total expenditure during this period was also 38% of the full year estimates. For 2020-21, an ambitious expenditure plan was drawn up in the budget, with expenditure budgeted to cross Rs 1 lakh crore from the Rs 88,900 crores that was estimated in 2019-20 budget. But a sharp fall in growth along with a contraction in revenues due to the pandemic means that the expenditure numbers are likely to be scaled down substantially.
Not least, the revocation of Article 370 has also brought about changes in the bureaucracy in the region. Our special correspondent Sanya Dhingra tells you about the concerns that have since cropped up because of these alterations.
One of the less talked about fallouts of Article 370, or in this case, more importantly, converting the erstwhile state of Jammu and Kashmir to a union territory, has been its impact on the bureaucracy of the state. As soon as the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act came into play, the Jammu and Kashmir cadre for IAS and IPS officers ceased to exist. Only for the newly recruited officers. According to the Act, while the already existing officers in the JNK cadre would continue serving in this cadre, the newly recruited officers would go to the Union Territory cadre of the IAS and IPS in India. What this has meant is a lot of confusion for officers in Jammu and Kashmir. A lot of them complain that why must we have two separate cadres of officers working in the same state? But this is just a logistical problem. There is a more serious problem at hand. Officers complain that this is going to give rise to a migratory bureaucracy in Jammu and Kashmir. What this means is that any officer being recruited into the Union Territory cadre can be posted from anywhere from Delhi to Chandigarh to Pondicherry to Jammu and Kashmir. That means an officer on an average have 3 to 5 years of a tenure in Jammu and Kashmir. This, officers say, is not going to give any officer the time or the opportunity to actually understand and get well versed with the politics, the security situation and the very, very peculiar societal problems of Jammu and Kashmir. The so-called migratory bureaucracy in Kashmir is likely to lead to another problem. In any case, the IAS and IPS officers serving in Kashmir faced some degree of resistance from the local population, considering they were seen as a symbol of Delhi in Kashmir. Now that these officers are actually not even going to stay in Kashmir and will belong to the Union Territory cadre, shuttling in and out of Kashmir every few years, they're likely to face even more resistance from the local population. Some officers say that for far too long, Jammu and Kashmir has been the tourist spot for India. The Jammu and Kashmir cadre should now not become the tourist cadre for IAS and IPS officers. Also, under the older rules, Jammu and Kashmir had a special provision. While in the rest of the country, 33% of the IAS officers serving in any state were promoted from the local state bureaucracy, in Kashmir, this number was 50%. This has been reduced and slashed down from 50 to 33%, further diluting the local representation in state bureaucracy. Finally, there is also a huge question mark on the temporariness of the Union Territory status of Jammu and Kashmir. Both the Prime Minister and the Home Minister have been on record to say that the Union Territory status of Jammu and Kashmir is temporary in nature, that is, the statehood of Jammu and Kashmir will soon be reinstated. Why then, officers ask, is the state bureaucracy being dismantled in such a fashion? But for now, what this act really means for the Jammu and Kashmir IAS and IPS officers is that they no longer report to the democratically elected government in Jammu and Kashmir, but the Ministry of Home Affairs in New Delhi.
Now, it didn't take very long for the debate to reach the Supreme Court. Over 20 petitions were filed. The first one was by serial PIL petitioner advocate M.L. Sharma. Other prominent petitioners include National Conference MPs Muhammad Akbar Lone and Hasnain Masoodi, former IAS officer Shah Faisal, activist Shehla Rashid, and the Jammu and Kashmir People's Conference. Among other things, the questions raised before the court include whether the procedure adopted to revoke Article 370 was legal. Now, let me explain how Article 370 itself was used to revoke Article 370. Clause 3 of Article 370 empowered the President to declare Article 370 inoperative at any time, but it said that the President can do so only on the recommendation of the Constituent Assembly. Since the Constituent Assembly for the state did not exist anymore, the first presidential order actually amended this part
to allow interpretation of the Constituent Assembly as the Legislative Assembly of the state. With this hurdle cleared, it then issued another presidential order, making the original Article 370 inoperative and changing it to make all the provisions of the Constitution applicable to the state. Like I had mentioned, Article 370 also allowed the President to extend various provisions of the Constitution to Jammu and Kashmir. So the first presidential order also cited the same provision to now extend all the provisions of the Indian Constitution to the state. Another question that has been raised in the Supreme Court is whether Article 370 was a temporary provision or had it attained a permanent status over the years, and whether the government actually has the power to break down a state into two union territories. The hearing in this case began on 10th December by a 5-judge bench. The matter was listed on 2nd March when the bench refused to refer the case to a larger bench of 7 judges. The case hasn't been heard since, with COVID-19 lockdown affecting the functioning of the courts across the country. While this case remains pending, the internet shutdown in the valley was also challenged in the Supreme Court. The petition did lead to safeguards being laid down in cases of internet shutdowns. However, the region continues to have only 2G internet, and a contempt petition has also been filed in the Supreme Court alleging that these safeguards are not being followed for the region. With COVID-19 considerably slowing down the judiciary and the complexity of the legal questions that have been raised in the petitions, a final Supreme Court decision on these issues seems like a long wait away. Till then, all eyes continue to remain on how the political, economic, and social dynamics in Kashmir will evolve and unfold. This is Apoorva Mandhani for The Print. For more such videos, subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook.